Grace and peace be to you through God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome all of you who are with us this morning in person and online as we gather to worship on the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. Good morning.
Good morning.
I would encourage us to pass the peace of Christ with those nearby and those who are able may continue standing as we begin with our opening hymn, Give to Our God in Morning Prayers. As we gather here, most gracious God, we pray that we may be receptive to the current, the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray that we may be open to its ability to transform us, not to the mold of this world, but to the renewal of our lives in Christ. And we ask for this in his name. Amen.
As the blood.
unison prayer of confession. We confess our struggle to be transformed into the disciples, God of mystery. The desires of the world would shape us into people you would not recognize. The demands of our society pull us away from your heart. Our culture values the rich, the powerful, the successful, but you are on the side of the weak, the poor, the outcast, the oppressed. Forgive us, merciful God, for looking for you in the wrong places. Reawaken us with your voice that calls us to service. Revive our weary hearts with your vision of creation. Refresh our fatigued spirits that we might boldly proclaim Jesus as our Lord and as our Savior, and go forth to serve your people in Christ's name. Amen. Hear the assurance of pardon. It's too easy to think like the world that money will give us happiness, that power will earn us grace. But Paul reminds us that if we think like Christ and live like servants, we will find true freedom.
Not only in our minds, but our hearts and spirits will be transformed into the likeness of Christ, enabling us to be faithful disciples. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Are there joys or concerns that we would like to lift up in our time of prayer this morning?
I'd like to say a prayer for Holly Beltman and her family. Holly was diagnosed with Guillain-Barré syndrome a couple of weeks ago. She's currently in a hospital on life support. She's going to be transferred to a nursing home for long-term rehabilitation. I'd like to say a prayer for her and her family for a speedy recovery.
Yes, Eddie. Mary.
For the people of Jacksonville and Austin and those in Oklahoma who suffered from gun violence this last week, prayers for thoughtfulness and peace.
Are there others? Let us then bow our heads as we come before the throne of God in a moment and in an attitude of prayer. Most gracious God, we are grateful for the gift of this day and for all that it represents and for all that may be possible in this day. We give you thanks for this chance to be together as part of your people, to draw strength from one another, to draw from the power of your Spirit and the inspiration of your Word, to help us to hear our summons and our call to be the people that you have created us to be. We pray that we may listen intently, that we may be molded and shaped as you would have us become. We pray that you would help us to focus our energies and attentions on the things of your kingdom first and foremost. We pray that you would help us to look for those things that make for healing and well-being in the lives of others and in the life of this world in general. We lift up in our prayers this morning Holly Beltman and her family as she's received a diagnosis of Guillain-Barré syndrome and is looking at lengthy rehabilitation and therapy. We pray that you would give her and her family strength in this time. We pray that your presence would be with Evie's son-in-law as he continues to go through treatment. We pray that you may give him and his family strength during this time of trial. We pray for the healing that must take place in places like Jacksonville, Oklahoma, and Boston, where there have been episodes of gun violence. And we pray that you may help us to see our way through these episodes to make them more rare, less lethal. We pray for the people of Hawaii as they still continue to assess damage, look for victims, try to rebuild the pieces of their lives. We pray that you would give them strength. We pray that you would open up our hearts in compassion to that suffering. We lift up in our prayers those who mourn and grieve losses recent, losses distant. We pray that your presence would be with the family of Ron Holzman at this time. We pray that you would be with others who have experienced loss, not just through death, but through other changes and disruptions in life. And loving God, we lift up before you in the silence of our hearts those concerns that we can only bring to you there. For the things we have named aloud, and for those things which each of us have brought before you in the silence of our hearts, we ask in Jesus' name, Amen.
Thank you.
Our reading from Hebrew Scripture this morning comes to us from the book of Exodus, the first chapter, verse 8, through chapter 2, verse 10. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom, Ramesses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of them was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him, but if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because she said, "I drew him out of the water." Our epistle lesson and the text for the message today comes to us from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 8. "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourselves more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. And our gospel lesson comes to us from Matthew's gospel, the 16th chapter, verses 13 through 20. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Thus ends the reading of our scripture. May God add a blessing to our hearing of it. During those visits that we made to the Milwaukee County Zoo when the guys were younger, we gave each of them an opportunity to take home one of those souvenir mold-o-rama projects that they had. They had 13 of those machines at the Milwaukee County Zoo, if you're familiar with the layout, and you put your coins in. Back in the day, I believe it was a dollar. Now I think it's up to $3. Tells you it's been a little while. And you could pick up a molded plastic figure of an elephant or a giraffe or a gorilla, a bat, or three monkeys, whatever, depending on what machine and what color of plastic you wanted to pick up. And so we, you know, gave the guys the quarters. We put them in and let them take it out and watch the process. And so it went. Now, there was a simple, predictable consistency about that. If, for example, you went to the mold-o-rama machine that was going to make elephants, and you put your money into the machine, it was 100% guarantee what you were going to get out at the end was an elephant. You were not going to get a gorilla. You weren't going to get a bat. You weren't going to get a giraffe. You weren't going to get a penguin. What came out at the end was an elephant, because the plastic was always going to be conformed and molded in such a way that an elephant was always going to be the result. You know, that's what it is to be conformed and molded into a mold like that. It's very simple and very predictable. And I think as it goes for the mold-o-rama machines at the Milwaukee County Zoo, I think it also goes for animate living objects as well. The raw material that goes into the forming of creatures produces creatures according to their mold and their kind. A horse will take after a horse's nature. A dog will become a dog and take after a dog's nature. A cat will take on a cat's nature, which means that a horse will not surprise you by going meow. A dog will not fly like a duck. A cat will not allow a bit to be put in its mouth and drag a plow. That's just not within the nature of the critters involved. They become whatever their nature determines they will be. And to a point, I think that happens with human beings as well. In as much as we can try to figure out and determine what human nature it is, we tend to follow in our own patterns of behavior. And I think there is the expectation, both by who we are physically and the pressures and the forces that are exerted on us socially, to wind up with certain ends and certain ways of becoming and acting. And some of those aren't so bad. At least in some circles, I think there is the expectation that human beings should act in certain ways, right action, right speech, do those right kinds of things. Those are good. But sometimes I think the pressure to be conformed and molded is not always a good thing. And sometimes we are in a situation where we don't always do the things that we should, and we don't always become the people that we ought to become. And sometimes that happens in our habits as well. We do not always become the people that are doing the right kinds of actions, and sometimes we get conformed in the same ways of thinking. I don't think it's a good thing that we think always in the same ways. One of my sayings is, if everybody's thinking the same thing, guess what? Somebody is not thinking. So it's good to have a little difference in the way that people think every once in a while. But rest assured, if you go against the grain of what is usually acceptable ways of thinking, there's going to be some pushback. You're going to get criticism. People might not like that. And if you say something radically different from everything else, you might well be deplatformed and not allowed to have the way to express it anymore. And another way that I think we become conformed in ways that are not good for us is that we look at ourselves perhaps more highly than we ought to. That we value ourselves and who we are perhaps more than we should. And I get it. You know, if we don't advocate for ourselves, we don't push for ourselves, who will? But sometimes I think that goes a little bit overboard. And certainly today, with all the social media platforms that we have, people are certainly expressing their worth and their importance in more ways than there used to be. There's Twitter, there's Facebook, there's Instagram, there's TikTok, and we get barraged by all kinds of messages on people's self-worth. Now, I will give a credit, a hat tip to Doug Bratt from the Center for Excellence in Preaching, who brought up this article that was written by David Brooks of The Atlantic back in July of 2022. And the name of the article was Proud to be Author of This Article. Humbled to be author of this article. And in the article, he latches on to a tweet that Christine Lagarde, who was the president of the European Central Bank, had shared with persons concerning an award she had received from the London School of Economics. And the tweet went something like this: I am humbled to receive this special award from the London School of Economics, this very prestigious award. And David Brooks had a little fun with that, needled Christine Lagarde about that. And he said, well, you know, whenever I receive something very important, I always feel humbled by it. Now, I never received an award from the London School of Economics, but if I was, I would share my humility about it by tweeting about it as much as possible, by sharing it on Instagram, and I'd even come up with something on TikTok if I could find dance moves that are commensurately humble enough with the award that I've experienced. In short, it's probably what some of us refer to as humble brag. And David Brooks says that it is not appropriate in our day and age to be humbled by appropriately humiliating things. But we don't go on social media and say, well, I was humbled by the fact that I was invited to this party and nobody there spoke to me. We don't say, I'm humbled by the fact that I was fired from my job for gross incompetence. No, that would be easy to be humbled by. Instead, we're supposed to be humbled by the awesomeness and the wondrousness of our accomplishments. That is something for which we ought to be humbled. That we ought to use the word humbled where the word exalted really should be more appropriate. And if we can promote our worthiness by promoting our humility, so much the better. I think a lot of that goes on in this world. But I got news for you, that's not a 21st century phenomenon. I think that's been going on for as long as people have been around. We just have more access to it on social media. People doing humble brag, people thinking more of themselves than they ought to. But, you know, Plato wrote that Socrates complained back in ancient Greece that there were prominent citizens of Athens who thought more of themselves than they ought to. And the Apostle Paul complains about that as well in our lesson from the letter to the Romans in chapter 12. And bear again, as we read through what Paul says to the Romans, beginning in verse 2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed to the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourselves more highly than you ought to think, in each in accordance to the measure of faith that God has assigned. Paul urges his readers not to think more highly of themselves than they ought to think, but instead of being formed like the world forms us, we ought to be transformed by the renewal of our minds. The unspoken part is in Christ Jesus, and that should be the solution for us having an overinflated sense of ourselves. Well, that's a mighty tall order. You know, how do we not wind up thinking more highly of ourselves than we ought to? Well, you back up a verse in chapter 12. Paul gives us a clue for that too. He said, I appeal to you therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. In essence, we offer ourselves up to God as a sacrifice, something which can be used, shaped, and molded. And the image I would like to go to is that rather than look at ourselves as being lumps of plastic that are conformed by the moldorama of the world, that instead we ought to view ourselves as being more like lumps of clay on the divine potter wheel, that it is a process of shaping and formation that does not take place in an instant, but takes place gradually, carefully, over the course of a lifetime. In that transforming, that renewal of our minds in Christ Jesus is something which does take a long period of time. We are not perfectible. I don't think our stint on the potter's wheel is one that ever ends for as long as we draw breath in this world. God is continually molding us and shaping us. It is when we do that, when we offer ourselves up to God, that we can become more and more the kinds of persons that God intends us to be. That is not always an easy thing. And that's only half the battle. Not viewing ourselves more highly than we ought to be viewed is only half the battle. What's the other half of the battle? Viewing others as being worthy. Viewing the gifts and the talents of other people as being worthy is the other half of the battle. And Paul goes back to that tried and true, you know, analogy that he uses in so many other different places in his letter. He talks about the church being the body of Christ. And each of us are members of that body. As the human body consists of many parts, so the body of the church consists of many parts. Each of us carries with us a different function. And that we ought to value the gifts and the functions that each of us brings to the body of Christ, that our gift is no more important, no more of value than anybody else's gift. And if we value and esteem the gifts of other people, that also helps us to put things in perspective as well. But friends, the challenge for us out of Paul's letter this morning is that we ought not to be conformed pieces of plastic that come out of the mold-o-rama of the world, but instead, maybe we ought to view ourselves as being more like that lump of clay on the potter's wheel, which is being shaped, transformed, molded by God for God's purposes. May God help us to be transformed by the renewal of our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Those who are able may stand for the singing of the hymn, Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken. The rest of the announcements, I commend your reading and consideration. We come now to this moment in our worship where we dedicate our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. We hear now the word of the Lord concerning the offering as it comes to us from the book of Deuteronomy in the 16th chapter, verse 17. All persons shall give as they are able according to the blessing of the Lord your God, which has been given to you. We will continue with our offertory response. We give thee what thine own. We pray that our offerings here this morning may express a level of gratitude, a level of sacrifice in these actions as well. And we pray that these gifts may find blessing in your sight. We ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us now pray that prayer that Christ our Savior has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
Thank you.
and one thing we're looking for.
Yeah.